ओम ज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपगदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्णा करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांत श्रीराधा कांत नमोस्तुते। तप्त कांचन गौरांगी श्रीराधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। नमो ओं विष्णुपदाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे। वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। Dear devotees, on behalf of ISKCON Chennai, we have great pleasure to welcome all of you for this special session on Krishna Leela. Taking this beautiful darshan of Radha Krishna, the deities of ISKCON Chennai, let us proceed with today's session to prepare all our hearts to welcome Lord Sri Krishna to take up his permanent residence there on the eve of impending Janmashtami festival, which is happening on the 12th of August. Let us prepare our hearts, let us plow our hearts so nicely that the beautiful devotion creeper of Krishna Bhakti can grow there. This creeper of Krishna Bhakti bears fruits of eternal love and eternal joy, which is the highest perfection of the soul. The soul is a part and parcel of Krishna, as we have already discussed, and it is moving towards perfection. Most people who have no spiritual knowledge, they do not understand what is the purpose of the Lord creating so many souls. But those who are in the know of things, who have studied the scriptures, they understand that the ultimate perfection of the spirit soul is eternal love and eternal joy in the association of Lord Sri Krishna. He is inviting all of us to give up our petty engagements in this material world, which is filling us with so much anxiety and anarthas. Lord Sri Krishna is telling, give up everything, surrender to me and come back. I am waiting for you there. I am having so many of my pure devotees enjoying eternal pastimes with me in Goloka. Please come and join. So with this introduction, let us proceed to enter into today's class. So the Mahamantra Sankirtana starts with chanting of Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu's holy names once. So let us chant together. Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. So before you chant the Hare Krishna mantra, this mantra will be chanted once. This will attract the mercy of the Lord so that many offenses we commit knowingly and unknowingly, they are removed so that we can get the full benefits of chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Otherwise, the Lord's name is transcendental, but our consciousness is still very much material. So in a material consciousness, when we chant the holy names, we tend to commit many offenses. But when we chant the holy names of Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he mercifully removes all these offenses so that we can get the full benefit of chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Let us chant the Mahamantra together. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. This you are chanting 108 times daily. Many people have responded to me saying that they are doing it twice, once in the morning and once in the evening. These are all very wonderful things. This will help you to progress very rapidly in Krishna consciousness, and your understanding and appreciation of the message of Srimad Bhagavad Gita will tremendously increase by regularly chanting the Maha Mantra. Now, we shall read shloka number 9 from chapter 4 of Bhagavad Gita, and then we will explain what it means. Please chant with me. Janma karma cha me divyam evam yo veti tatvatah tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti sorjuna. Again, janma karma cha me divyam evam yo veti tatvatah tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti sorjuna. Translation: one who knows the transcendental nature of my appearance and activities does not take his birth again in this material world, but attains my eternal abode, O Arjuna. So Krishna is telling Arjun on the battlefield, Arjun, it is not very difficult to come back to me. It is so very easy actually. How? You have to know who Krishna is. You have to know that Krishna is not a human being like you and me. A human being is a soul imprisoned in a material body. That is a human being. Everyone existing in this material world is actually a pure spirit soul, but encaged in a body made of matter. Because matter is constantly changing, but the soul is unchanging, it creates a incompatible situation. It forces us to undergo old age, disease, death, and rebirth again and again. So when we see Krishna also taking birth in this material world, we tend to conclude that he is a human being like everyone. So he is also subject to old age, disease, and death. And his birth is also an ordinary birth from a mother's womb like everyone else. So how can he be God? So these are the kind of doubts that people generally entertain. When they see a human-like body of Krishna and they conclude that it is a human body, they think, oh, Krishna is also going to be subjected to hunger, thirst, you know, desire for the opposite sex and various material desires like accumulating wealth and enjoying sense gratification. People think that Krishna is a human being and he will also have all these desires. But Krishna is cautioning us through this shloka, at the same time giving us tremendous hope by saying, Arjun, please understand that I am beyond material nature. I am not made up of material elements like your body is. My body and my soul are not two things. I am pure soul as I am standing in front of you. I am your very Paramatma, which is sitting in your heart. I am standing in front of you. My body is not subjected to old age, disease, death, and uncontrolled rebirth in some mother's womb based on karma. I am not bound by karma. Karma is a law made by me, and I am not subjected to the laws of karma. And when I want to take birth, I take birth. So Krishna says, understand that I am coming from a place which is beyond material creation. So in fact, I am not taking birth. I am only appearing here. I am appearing here. When he says Janma, it is not like us. That Janma here is actually appearance. And when Krishna leaves, it is not death. It is disappearance. So we have to understand this difference. He is using the word Divyam. If you see in the first line, Divya. Divya means it is not material, non-material. It is transcendental, beyond the control of material nature. Evam yo veti. Veti means one who comes to know, one who understands. Tattvataha. Tattva means the absolute truth. So if you know the absolute truth of Krishna's birth and activities, karma, janma, karma, birth and activities, such a person, tyaktva deham, when they give up the body, punarjanma naiti, they don't take birth again. And what do? Mameti, they come back to me, Arjuna. So this is what Krishna is saying. So today's class, if you are going to be very attentive, if you are trying to understand sincerely with devotion in your heart that Krishna is a transcendental personality, then your return to the spiritual world becomes assured. Your devotion to Krishna begins to grow in your heart. So let us proceed further. So the divine appearance of Lord Sri Krishna, we have already discussed in our Gita Mahatmyam class. I will not spend much time on it here. Please understand that the four-armed Vishnu, Chaturbhuja Vishnu, is standing in front of Devaki and Vasudev inside the prison house. How did he come? He just appeared there. The prison had so many gates and so many security people, but nothing stopped Mahavishnu from appearing there in front of Devaki and Vasudev. And then he kindled the feelings of parental affection in their hearts. He first assured them, "My dear father and mother, have no fear. I have come to save you and liberate you." And he was in his full splendor. Shankha, Chakra, Gada, Padma, his Vaijayanti Mala, his Kaustubha jewels, his Srivatsa markings, his golden Pitambara dress, his wonderful helmet, crown made of Vaidurya gems. And he was standing in front of them with his long hair and his beautiful smile, his lotus petal-like eyes, and he was smiling and giving them reassurance. But when he kindled the feelings of parental affection in their hearts, they forgot that he is God. And they started thinking, he is my child. And immediately Devaki remembered her six children who had been killed by Kamsa. So she immediately begs him, "Please Lord, cover this form, become an ordinary child, so that I can beg Kamsa to save your life. If he sees you like this, he will try to kill you." You may feel like laughing that somebody can fear that Vishnu can be killed, but her motherly affection created this motherly anxiety in her heart. And Vishnu was so pleased, he became a little child. And that was how Krishna was born. So Krishna was born as a Chaturbhuja Vishnu. So nobody should think that he is an ordinary human being. That is the main purpose we wanted to show this slide here. Then 16 gates are there for the prison house built by Kamsa, where he kept Devaki and Vasudev imprisoned. Those 16 gates, according to our acharyas, represent the five elements of our human body, that is earth, water, fire, air, and space. And then our five karmendriyas. Karmendriyas are our hands, our legs, our power of speech, our power of evacuation. You know, the genitals and the where we pass stools. That five organs are called karma indriyas. Then we have five jnana indriyas, which is our eyes, nose, ears, sense of taste and touch. So five elements and five karma indriyas, five jnana indriyas, and then mind, which is supervising over everything. These are the 16 gates in which we are all imprisoned. Our soul is imprisoned behind these 16 gates. But when Lord Krishna appeared, first in the heart of Vasudev, then in front of him, and Vasudev was carrying Lord Krishna on his head, all the 16 gates opened. So please remember, we should also one day open all the 16 gates of our prison house, and then we shall be able to go back to Krishna, carrying only love in our heart and nothing else. And now, we are going to talk about Vatsalya Rasa. Today we have picked up a Leela of Krishna through which we shall discuss Vatsalya Rasa. In last week's class, we discussed the interaction between Krishna and his devotees give rise to many rasas, many mellows, many tastes. And Krishna is called the Rasa Raj, which means Krishna is very capable of generating very profound transcendental emotions in the hearts of his devotees. And these emotions are far beyond any kind of happiness that we experience. And this is what makes Krishna special. Many people think, you know, God means all powerful, you know, he knows everything, he controls everything, he destroys everything. And people think that is why God is great. But actually, Krishna, the Supreme Lord, shows us that those are all very inferior qualities with which people of this world are obsessed. The real wonderful quality of Krishna is his ability to attract all the souls towards himself. His ability to attract all souls to himself. And then the ability to flood them with joy, flood them with love towards himself. So he will attract us and then he will give us love to himself. And through that love, he will initiate so many service activities on our part. And we will be drowned in an ocean of joy and love. This is what is the special feature of Krishna. You know, you try and compare Krishna with all the gods we know. And then try and imagine whether these kind of relationships, what we are going to discuss today, is possible with any of the other gods that you know and you worship. So, the purpose of worshipping God is not to get our material desires fulfilled. The purpose of worshipping the Supreme Lord is to open the 16 gates we saw in the previous slide and then return back to Krishna in Goloka, where we can have eternal loving pastimes with him and free from all worries and anxieties of old age, disease, death and rebirth. So now we shall discuss the Vatsalya Rasa. Here we see in front of us Yashoda Mai sitting with Lord Shri Krishna in her lap. She is the highest realization of Vatsalya Rasa. Vatsalya means motherly affection towards Krishna. The affection of elderly people towards Krishna as a dependent child. And we are going to discuss Damodar Leela today. Damodar Leela, you know Krishna is called Damodar, but many of you may not know the meaning of this word Damodar. Dam means rope. Dama, you know, means rope in Sanskrit. And Udara means the abdomen. So the Lord who is tied with a rope around his waist is called Dama Udar. Dama Udar. He has got a rope around his waist. Why he has to be given a name like this? Because can anyone imagine tying up God with a rope? We say all the universes are in his belly. Then how long a rope you need to tie his belly, which contains all creation? But who can tie him up except a pure devotee in love? So the rope, what we are talking about here, Dama, is nothing but love. So by love he is tied. So this is the understanding of the Supreme Lord. The Supreme Lord is very great. There is no doubt about it. But he is looking for love from all of us. All the unlimited number of souls he has created only because he has unlimited ability to give and receive love. So here is another definition of God. He is the one who is capable of receiving and giving unlimited amounts of love eternally, drowning us in love and joy forever. So here we are going to talk about how Yashoda tied the Supreme Lord with the rope of her love. And here we see Yashoda, his mother in Gokula, she is constantly remembering Krishna. Not only Yashoda, all the gopas and gopis, Nanda Maharaja, all of them, the cows and the calves in Gokula, they are constantly meditating on Krishna. they cannot live without remembering him constantly. They may forget themselves, but they will only remember Krishna. So, because Krishna is stealing butter from all neighboring houses, Yashoda thought, I will make some super butter for him and I'll make some wonderful dishes for him so that he will never think of going to the neighborhood houses and stealing. So thinking, and because Krishna, once he wakes up, he will not allow her to do this service. She woke up very early, around 3 o'clock in the morning, and she started churning the curd herself. She is a queen. She could have told any of her servants to do this job, but no. When you love someone, you will personally want to do the service. I don't know, some of you might have heard the story of Akbar and Birbal. Akbar asked Birbal, Birbal, you Hindus, you say your God himself personally appears to save his devotees, but what is the need? He has so many servants here in this world. He can use any of them to protect his devotees. Why does he have to personally come? Birbal did not answer. But then when they were going in a boat ride, suddenly Birbal picked up the child of Akbar and threw him into the sea. And immediately what happened? Akbar jumped into the water. And with some difficulty, he secured his son and came back to the boat, and very angrily, he looked at Birbal. Birbal, why did you do this? Then Birbal smiled and said, oh, Akbar Badshah, you are the emperor of Bharat, but you could have asked any of your servants who are all in this boat, so many of them, they would have jumped and picked up your son. But why did you jump? He said, he's my son. He's very special to me. That is why. Then Birbal explained, now you understand, our Krishna is like that. We are all his children. So if we are in difficulty, he cannot bear it and he has to personally come. So that is the kind of love that Krishna is constantly giving to us. But we are unable to receive it because love of Krishna has not yet sprouted fully in our heart. Actually, the scriptures explain love of Krishna is in the heart of every soul. But it is covered by kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsari. So the scriptures, Bhagavad Gita, will help us to remove these impurities, the contaminations covering our pure soul. And once these contaminations go, our love for Krishna will automatically appear. It is already there. It has only got covered. So Yashoda, in the early morning, personally goes to churn her curd into butter. And she is very careful not to make any sound because in the nearby room, Krishna is nicely sleeping. So she starts churning. And while churning, what she does? She sings beautiful songs of Krishna's pastimes. This is what in Gokula and Vrindavana, people are always doing. What they are doing? They are always discussing the pastimes that Krishna did. Every day, after they go for grazing the cows and come back, the young Gopa boys will go and tell their parents, you know, this is what happened today, you know, this is what Krishna did today. Immediately they will make some nice songs out of it and they will be going on singing that. Same way, Yashoda is singing the pastimes of Krishna and then nicely churning the butter. And then, you know, unconsciously her bangles are also making a nice sound as she is churning the butter. And as she is singing the glories of her son, her love increases so much that tears are coming from her eyes and milk is flowing from her breast automatically by remembering her child. And then, you know, Krishna, who is supposed to be sleeping, immediately realizes, here is my devotee, and in complete ecstasy of my love. And Krishna wants to reciprocate. Krishna wants to come and receive that love. So within no time, Krishna is standing in front of Yashoda. Yashoda cannot even see Krishna there because she is absorbed in thinking about him and her eyes are covered with her tears. So she goes on churning. Then, you know, Krishna, what he does? He holds the churning rod and stops mother from churning. And then immediately Yashoda opens her eyes widely and she says, oh, my child is here and he's so smart. He is holding the churning rod. Then, you know, Krishna makes a sign that, mother, take me on your lap. I want to drink your milk. Immediately, Yashoda stops her work and then takes Krishna on her lap and she starts feeding him her milk. And while doing that, she's looking at the beautiful face of her son, and Krishna is also looking at her face. The lotus-like eyes of Krishna, which goes up to his ears, his nice bud-like nose, his red lips, and inside, beautiful pearl-like teeth, you know, just appearing, only a few teeth are there. Whether Krishna is also looking at his mother and smiling, and both are absorbed in this transcendental exchange of love. While this is happening, suddenly Yashoda realizes that she has kept milk on the stove for boiling, and the sound of the milk boiling, she is able to hear. What she does immediately, she puts Krishna down and she goes to remove the milk from the stove. Actually, what for she is boiling that milk? Also for Krishna only. Every action that happens in Gokula and Vrindavan is only meant for the pleasure of Krishna. Here she is feeding Krishna her own milk, which is for his pleasure, but she is now going to save the milk, which is a very special milk. I will take half an hour to discuss the speciality of this milk. You know, Nanda Maharaja has got almost 10 lakh cows, and these, out of these 10 lakh cows, 108 cows are very special. Out of this 108, there are 8 very, very special cows. And these cows are called Padmagandha cows. And they are fed a very special kind of grass which grows in some parts of Govardhan Hill only. And those grass smell like lotus. So Padmagandha grass. And these cows eat that. And when they give milk, the milk has the beautiful fragrance of lotus in it. And that milk is what mother has collected, and she's going to make nice sweets for Krishna. That is why she's going to save it. But then Krishna becomes very angry. Krishna says, how could you neglect me? He's thinking like that. How could you neglect me and go for doing some other work? So immediately he looks around, and then he sees there is one stone kept, you know. With that stone, he breaks that pot. And all the curd and butter which is just forming, it is flowing all over the place. Then Krishna immediately realizes that he has done something wrong, and mother is going to be happy. Mother is going to be very angry. So he is looking here and there and starts moving away from that place to the next room. And there, what happens is, he is seeing a ukkal, you know, the grinding mortar where they grind things, you know, grains and all. He sees that, and he sees butter hanging from pots from the roof. So what he does, he climbs on the grinding mortar and then pulls down the pot of butter, and then he calls monkeys, and all the monkeys are coming in. So Acharyas explain, these are monkeys that had served him during Ramavatar. And they are now coming in his Krishna form to receive butter from his own hands. So he feeds butter to all the monkeys. The monkeys are enjoying. And then suddenly Krishna is able to sense that something is going to happen. Mother is going to come. Immediately he jumps down. He also notices that the monkeys are making some odd sounds and start running. So he immediately realizes mother is here. And then he jumps out of the ukkal and starts running. And Mother Yashoda, carrying a small stick in her hand to threaten her child, she is behind him. You know, she went back to the place after saving the milk, and she saw that the place is filled with curd, and then she could see his little footprints, you know. So she followed the footprints, and then she reached the room where Krishna is there. And she was walking very carefully, but Krishna was warned by the monkeys. So he started running, and mother started chasing him. And then what happens? This we have already explained, that mother's dilemma, which service is important for me? Now I am feeding Krishna my milk, but this Padmagandha milk is also important. So mother was in a position to choose one of these services. So she is in any case fully absorbed in the service of Krishna. We should also be like that. we should also be aspire to be like that. When I go for a job, I go for Krishna. When I cook for Krishna. When I maintain my children and look after them, I do that for Krishna, so that one day I can make them nice devotees of Krishna. Like that, we should link all our activities with Krishna. And if there are some activities which you cannot link with Krishna, they are the dangerous activities. They are the ones we should give up. Otherwise, as a family man, as a householder, as a grihastha, we can connect all our thoughts, words, and actions to Krishna. And that pleases him immensely. There is no need for us to give up anything. We have to only give up our own attachment to things and become attached to Krishna. So here, Krishna, it is said in the Shastra, he is feared by fear itself. He is the Supreme Lord. It is said in the Shastras, out of fear for the Lord, the sun rises. Out of fear for the Lord, the wind blows. That is how much all the devatas respect him. But here, Yashoda Mai is chasing him with a small stick, and see how Krishna is running with fear in his eyes. And then the Shastras say, the Supreme Lord, so many yogis and jnanis are doing tapasya for thousands of years so that they can catch him in their hearts. But Krishna escapes from them. Krishna can never be caught by a yogi or a jnani ever. They can do thousands of years of tapasya, but Krishna cannot be obtained in that way. But here, Mother Yashoda is chasing Krishna, and Krishna is running. Where is the hope of catching Krishna? But then her flowers in the hair, you know, they are falling down from the effort. Her body is perspiring, you know, her dress is loosening. And Krishna, while running, he is looking back. And when he sees his mother taking so much pains to catch him, he slows down a bit and allows the mother to catch him. So these are all very beautifully explained in the scriptures. But today we will go a little fast because there's a lot to be covered. But then Krishna gets caught by the mother, who cannot be caught by the greatest yogis. What Mother Yashoda is doing? She is only constantly remembering Krishna. She is doing, singing about him, and she is hearing the glories of Krishna and is constantly remembering Krishna, and all the activities that she is doing at home is for the pleasure of Krishna. This is what Mother Yashoda is doing, and she has become the greatest yogi. Krishna would say in Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna, Yoginam api sarvesham madgatena antaratmana shraddhavan bhajate yoma same yuktatamo mataha. Krishna says, Arjun, don't think any yogi is greater than my bhakta. The person who is constantly remembering me in my heart and surrendering to me, he is the greatest of all yogis. This is my conclusion. Same yukta tamo mataha. It is my conclusion that only my devotee is the greatest yogi. So Yashoda Ma is the greatest yogi. And then out of her love, she has caught Krishna. One who can never be caught. Isha Upanishad says, God, even if the devatas have vehicles which can run at the speed of the mind, and they chase him for thousands of years, they can never catch him. Even Brahma Samhita says, Pantastu koti satavatsara sampragamyo vayorudapi manaso muripungavanam sopyastiyat prapadasim avichintya tatve govindam adipurusham tamaham bhajami. Brahmadeva worships Krishna with this wonderful shloka. He says, even if the greatest yogis, they get hold of chariots that can run at the speed of the wind, then he says, no, at the speed of mind, if they chase him for hundreds of crores of years, he cannot be caught. Hundreds of crores of years with a vehicle that can run at the speed of mind, and the yogis cannot catch him. But see how easily Mother Yashoda caught him. Now, please consider, is it possible for us to catch him? Yes, for sure. Why? Developing our pure love for him, which is lying hidden in our heart. Just like when you drill a well, when you dig a well, you go on getting dry rocks and mud while you start. You know, when dry rocks and soil come, You go on digging, then you start getting some moist soil, you know. Then finally, somewhere one stone is there and you move it, and then the spring of water gushes out. The water was always there. It was only covered with so much mud and stones. But when you remove that, the water is gushing out. Same way, love of Krishna is in all our hearts. But what is the process of digging our heart? We are doing it right now. Shravanam Kirtanam. Somebody talks about Krishna, that is Kirtanam. Somebody hears about him, that is Shravanam. We are now churning love of Krishna in our hearts. And by constantly meditating on Krishna like this, we will dig the well of our heart deeply, and one day love of Krishna will start coming out. After that, there is no stopping. After that, for eternity, we drown in that love of Krishna. And here you see Krishna, who does all the mischief, and now he is looking so innocent and he is crying in front of his mother. It is so beautifully explained in Damodar Ashtakam, which is written by Satyavrata Muni. Another day we will discuss, there are 8 shlokas in that, 8 very beautiful shlokas. In that he describes how Krishna is crying, and he's with his hand, he is squeezing his eyes, and all the black mascara is flowing down on his body, and his neck, you know, you can see he's gasping, and the 3 nice lines in his neck, you know, they are moving up and down, and his chest is heaving. There is genuine fear in his eyes. And he says, mother, you are having that stick. It's a tiny stick she's having. Mother, please throw it away. Immediately, Yashoda can sense, you know, my son has become very afraid. That is not good. She throws the stick away. And then, let us see what happens. Mother says, Krishna, for your own good, I have to teach you some good lessons. Otherwise, you are constantly getting into trouble. And when you grow up, you will become very uncontrolled rascal. So I have to teach you some good discipline. So I am going to tie you up. So she starts tying him up. Such a small child, how much rope is required? So she thinks, okay, I have the rope, I will tie him up. So the same ukkal, you know, from which he was stealing the butter from the roof, that ukkal she brings, and she tries to tie him along with the grinding mortar, right? That rope she brings around the grinding mortar and around his waist, and then she is going to tie it. You know, it is 2 fingers short. 2 fingers short. Then she says, all right, let me go and procure some more rope. She goes and gets some all silken ropes, you know, for Krishna's waist, not this coconut coir rope. It's all silken ropes. And she's again attaching some rope and she's trying to tie him up. No way. By this time, the gopis have all assembled. They are always meditating on Krishna. So when something is happening, they all come. So all the gopis have come. And then Yashoda has exhausted all her rope in the house. She tells the gopis, please go and bring ropes from your houses. So gopis laughingly go and bring some more ropes. And you may be wondering, when so many ropes are attached, the rope will become so long. That means Krishna must be growing all the time, you know. His waist must be growing big. But no, that is for ordinary people. Krishna is the same size. His waist is, as usual, very thin. Such a beautiful little child. Just 2-3 years old. But the rope is not sufficient. So after some time, the gopis are telling Mother Yashoda, this is not the day for tying up Krishna. You know, the Narayana is not willing to let Krishna to be tied. You give up your effort. Yashoda is sweating all over her body and she is trying so hard. But then she says, no. It is for the good of my son that I am doing. Let me see the size of my son's waist today. I will not give up. When Krishna sees mother struggling, gasping and sweating heavily, Krishna again becomes very compassionate. And he allows her to tie him up. What happens? Every time she adds rope, there is always 2 fingers too short. And all the gopis are astonished. How is it? We are attaching so many ropes, but every time only 2 fingers short. How is it happening? But ultimately, Krishna allows himself to be tied. This is explained by acharyas like this. You know, Krishna is full of various energies. These energies are all called Lakshmis. Krishna's energies are all Lakshmis. There are unlimited number of Lakshmis, which are the energies of Krishna, and they don't want Krishna to be tied. And they are the ones who are stopping Krishna from getting tied up. But when ultimately the queen, the ultimate, the highest Lakshmi is Krishna's quality of compassion. All these Lakshmis are actually various qualities of Krishna. Qualities of Krishna. But what is the greatest quality? His compassion. His love for his devotees is the highest quality of Krishna. So when the queen came, all the other Lakshmis became silent. No, they withdrew. And then this queen compassion told Krishna, hey, it is enough. You have troubled your mother enough. Now get tied up. So Krishna finally agreed to get tied up by his mother. And then she tied him with the ukal. And so all the rope was insufficient, but the two fingers too short. That is explained by acharyas very beautifully. What is the two finger too short? The one finger is the effort of the mother, the sincere, loving, enthusiastic effort of the mother. We all should be like that. We want Krishna prema. We want to have Krishna in our hearts. For that purpose, we should be willing to work hard. How is it possible to work hard? By having love of Krishna in our heart. We should love Krishna. We should love devotees. We should love the wonderful qualities and form and the holy names of Krishna. By constantly remembering Krishna in our hearts and constantly talking and hearing about him and associating with devotees and reading these wonderful devotional books, we should develop love for Krishna. That is our endeavor. But one finger length, if you get rope, not enough, because still there is one finger left. What is that one finger left? That is the mercy of Krishna. So on top of all our efforts, Krishna is supremely independent. Even if we make all the efforts, Krishna need not become bound. Krishna will become bound only when he himself wants to become bound. In this case of Yashoda, we saw with all the ropes in Gokul, he could not be bound. But ultimately, Krishna felt compassion for his mother, and that is when he got tied. But before that, Yashoda had to exhaust all her endeavor. So this is the loving exchanges between devotee and Krishna. So all of us have wonderful lessons to learn from this, that this is the way we can capture Krishna in our hearts. So our endeavor and the causeless mercy of Krishna are the two things that we need. Then we can tie Krishna in our hearts and he can never escape from there. There is a beautiful song called Chaurashtakam. In the Chaurashtakam, the poet says, ultimately, Krishna, you have been such a thief and you have stolen so many things, but ultimately now I have captured you and I have put you in a prison of my heart. Now let us see how you can escape from there. I will never allow you to leave from there. You are imprisoned in my heart forever. Let us all do that. Let us all determine in our heart that we will get him into our heart by constantly expressing our love to him. So then, you know, Krishna hits always many mangoes in one stone. Now mother has tied him up. Now he is thinking, you know, what can I do? Mother has gone to attend to other work. And Krishna is pulling that grinding mortar between two huge trees that are standing in the backyard of Nanda Maharaja. Yamala Arjuna trees, they are called. They grow very tall. These trees were 5,000 years old at that time. And there were two devatas occupying that tree. Actually, they were in the form of the tree because of a curse. And when Krishna pulled the mortar between the two trees fell with a huge noise. You may wonder, the trees are so strong means either the rope should have broken or the ukal should have broken or Krishna should not be able to pull. But how did all this happen? Okay, Krishna is God, but the rope is only ordinary. But please remember, the rope is in connection with Krishna. Anything in connection with Krishna becomes Krishnaized. If you connect your heart to Krishna, it develops the qualities of Krishna. Any devotee connected to Krishna has Krishna in his heart, and he becomes transcendental. He gets all the transcendental powers within his heart. So similar way, because the rope is connected to Krishna and the ukal is connected through the rope to Krishna, they all are transcendental now. So the two trees fell down. For us, there is a message here. We should understand, we should always remain connected to Krishna. Or we should remain connected to those who are connected to Krishna. That is also very powerful way. The ukal is not directly connected to Krishna, but it is connected to the rope which is connected to Krishna. That way, the ukal is also becoming transcendental. Now see, the trees are broken and the two devatas are taking the blessings of Krishna. Krishna is still looking at them as a very innocent baby, but these two people take his blessings and they return to the Gandharva Loka. We will see their story briefly. They were originally the sons of Kuvera. They were called Nalakuva and Manigriv. They are the sons of Kuvera. They are very beautiful yakshas, you know, very beautiful bodies they have. And they are so proud of it with their wealth and their beauty. And they are playing in a lake along with beautiful women. You know, they are just enjoying. And who is coming that side? Narada Muni is coming. So Narada Muni is the best devotee of Lord Vishnu and Krishna. And he is standing in front of them, but they have no shame. They are not even giving any respect to him. All the ladies, you know, they become shy and they cover themselves. But these two men are standing, you know, they are drunk, and they are drunk with liquor and also with pride of their beauty and wealth. And say they are not giving any respect to Narada Muni. Does Narada Muni become angry? No. What Narada Muni becomes is compassionate, because they have got such a high birth, but they are misusing it. Like, we are all having a human form of life, but until we come to know Bhagavad Gita, we are actually misusing our life. We are always trying to enjoy my senses. How can I enjoy more? Can I eat some meat? Can I drink some liquor? Can I take some drugs and other intoxicants? Can I go after the opposite sex? Can I gamble and enjoy myself? We are constantly thinking how to enjoy. But such a nature makes a devotee compassionate, that I should teach them the proper lesson and put them on the proper track. So Narada gave them a curse that both of you take birth as Yamalarjuna trees, and this is your punishment. But your punishment will be ended when Krishna himself will come and liberate you. So you see, it is actually not a punishment. The 5,000 years they stood as Yamalarjuna trees, they started regretting their behavior. Their minds became soft and pure, like churned butter. You know, they became nice devotees of Krishna. And then Krishna appeared and they could see his childhood pastimes. And ultimately, Krishna personally came and liberated them. And he blessed them that because Narada Muni has given you actually not a curse, a blessing, I also bless you that you will never forget me. You can now return to your father, but at the end of your life, you will come back to me in Goloka and be my pure devotees. So these are the two Yamalarjuna trees who got liberated. Now let us see another shloka of Krishna. This is in the 9th chapter, 11th shloka. Krishna speaks to Arjun. Please chant with me. Avajananti mamudha manushim tanumashritam param bhavam ajananto mama bhuta maheshwaram. Again. Avajananti mamudha manushim tanumashritam param bhavam ajananto mama bhuta maheshwaram. Translation. Fools deride me when I descend in the human form. They do not know my spiritual nature as the Supreme Lord of all that be. By now, you would have understood that Krishna's birth is not ordinary, and Krishna is not an ordinary human being. Krishna selected his parents. How does he select? By the quality of their love. Ultimately, Krishna is developing all of us. Now you can understand what is the meaning of evolution. When you read evolution in your science textbook, that did nothing to your heart, no transformation happened. You read, okay, evolution, we came from monkeys, and the monkeys came from something else, and so there is no goal for life. All this evolution is happening automatically. There is no particular goal. There is no creator. The world exists without any reason. Everything is an accident. We thought like that. But now, after reading Gita, after hearing the words of Krishna, we understand there is a purpose. Now, you can clearly understand what is the purpose. The purpose is to evolve our soul, which has completely forgotten Krishna. Now, we will gradually evolve to pure love of Krishna. Slowly, slowly, love of Krishna will come in our heart. And as the love comes, all the bad qualities in us will be destroyed. All anger, greed, lust, pride, envy, illusion, all this will go. And in that place, love of Krishna and all good qualities will arise. You know, we will become compassionate to people. We will become loving and caring towards people. We will become increasingly selfless and fearless. And we will try to help people as much as possible. And over and above everything, we will see the presence of Krishna in everything. And then your love will expand and overflow in the whole world. And that is the love of Krishna. When you connect to the love of Krishna, the Krishna love flows through you and drowns the whole world. That is why devotees are called Ajata Shatru. Ajata Shatru means there is no enemy for them. Somebody may think of them as enemy, but the devotee will never think of anyone as his enemy, because he sees Krishna in everyone. The Paramatma is in everyone. So he has no enemies. So Krishna here says, even though they have seen the unusual birth of Krishna and the unusual activities of Krishna, with a little finger of the left hand, he can balance the huge Govardhan hill for 7 days and seven nights. And he could kill Putana when he was a day's old child, and Trinavarta and Bakasur and Agasur. All these leelas he did. But even then, who will say he is only a human being? Only fools. So Krishna uses the word mudha, fools and rascals. Avajananti. Jananti means no. Avajananti means do not know. They do not know my param bhavam. Param means transcendental nature. They don't know, because I am coming in a human body. Manushim tanum ashritam. I am taking a human-like body and descending into this world. It's not a human body. It's a spiritual body always, but it is a human-like body. In that body, Krishna has come, but he is completely spiritual. Spiritual means, please remember this point. Spiritual means we also carry a spirit spark in us. In our heart, there is a spirit spark, but it is covered by matter, material elements, earth, water, fire, air and space, that is covering the soul inside our body. Only a tiny spark of spirit is inside us. But Krishna is complete spirit. There is no material element in him. In fact, anything that touches Krishna becomes spiritual instantly. And that is why, you know, we can give the example of a magnet and a piece of iron. What we do with a magnet and a piece of iron? We go on rubbing the magnet on the iron. What happens? After some time, the iron develops magnet-like qualities. Similarly, if you put an iron rod into burning fire and you keep it there for a sufficient length of time, what happens? The rod becomes like fire. It develops the qualities of fire. If you take that red-hot rod and you touch anything, that will also burn. But the quality is not inherent in the rod, but by keeping it sufficiently in the fire, it develops fire-like qualities. Similarly, by constantly remembering Krishna, we will develop the qualities of Krishna. And then the loving exchange between the spirit soul and Krishna, who is the complete, from whom all these souls have come. That relationship between Krishna and the soul is called prema. Prema means selfless love. Selfless love. That love is possible only between Krishna and all the souls. And that is our evolution. We are all evolving towards that pure love of Krishna. After that, we have no business in this material world. We return to the spiritual world. So Krishna is telling, fools do not know that I am not a human being. I am the Supreme Lord. And so they never understand my nature. What is that nature? Mama Bhuta Maheshwaram. I am the supreme controller of all. That they do not know. So this is Krishna's revelation to us. So with this, we are coming to the end of this today's session. Let us say a few words about Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada's birth happened exactly the day after Janmashtami. So Janmashtami, this time it is coming on 12th, Wednesday. And the day following that is Prabhupada's appearance day. That is also a very, very special day because he is a pure devotee who is coming from Krishna. And I said, anything that touches Krishna is Krishnaized. Similar way, he is a pure devotee coming from Krishna. And you see how much he has spread Krishna consciousness throughout the world. So, you know, because Krishna was born on the midnight of 12th, we observe a fast on that day in love of Krishna. Krishna takes birth in the midnight, so we don't eat anything, or we can only eat fruits. If we cannot completely starve, we eat only fruits. And in any case, we don't eat any grains. Observing this fast on Krishna Janmashtami is very, very auspicious. It is equal to observing thousands of Ekadashis, Janmashtami day. So, dear devotees, we can all try this. We can observe a complete fast, or we can have a fruit fast. If we cannot even do that, at least we should avoid taking any grains. Okay, we can take sabudana, things like that. We can take roots, like potato and all that, that we can take. That let us try and observe this fast. And so Krishna's birthday is a fast. But next day is Prabhupada's appearance day. And that is the day we have a feast. But when do we have that feast? We have the feast in the afternoon. We perform a puja, Guru Puja to Srila Prabhupada. And then we have a huge feast. And that feast, you know, it's called Nanda Utsav. Nanda Utsav means Nanda Maharaja celebrating the birth of Krishna, right? So Krishna is taking birth at midnight. So the celebration happens on Prabhupada's appearance day. The day Prabhupada was born, it is always the Nanda Utsav. So how beautifully Krishna arranges the birth of his devotee also in such a special way. Srila Prabhupada was born to wonderful Vaishnava parents. And right from childhood, his father would bring Vaishnava sannyasis home every day. And he would feed them and he would give them some donations and he would beg them, please, please bless my son that he should become a devotee of Radharani. Why? Radharani is the greatest devotee of Krishna. Of course, Radharani and Krishna are the same. But Radharani represents pure love of Krishna. She is the greatest lover of Krishna. And so we all should follow in her footsteps. We should all become worshippers of Radharani and beg her, please connect us with Krishna. So his father would pray like that. And so Srila Prabhupada, from the time he was born, and he grew up, he was a pure devotee. At the age of 5, he performed Jagannath Ratayatra on the streets of Calcutta, along with his friends. And it happened so well, you know, people used to cook huge amounts of prasadam. Adults took part in that Ratayatra with so much enthusiasm after seeing the 5-year-old Abhay. His name was Abhay Charanaravinda. The father who had given him name, Abhay Charanaravinda. So he would perform this wonderful Leela. And from childhood, he never forgot Krishna. When some of his disciples, Western disciples, asked him, Prabhupada, when did you become Krishna conscious? Prabhupada said, for a moment also, I have never forgotten Krishna from the time I was born. And till he died, he remembered Krishna. In his final moment, you know what he was doing? For 1 year, he was sick. And his body was just bones and skin, nothing else. But in that condition, he was translating Srimad Bhagavatam, Dasamaskanda. People were holding a dictaphone to his mouth and they would read the shloka, and Prabhupada would speak the translation into the dictaphone. His consciousness was very clear. You cannot imagine a person in such a body, how can the consciousness be so clear? So till his last moment, he taught us valuable lessons that a devotee of Krishna is the perfection of the soul. So with this, we come to the end of today's session. I request all of you to join in tomorrow's session at the same time. Let us now all of us chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra 3 times. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.